Subaru, you haven't done fucking anything since we fucking left school, mate. Like, apart from get fucking wrecked.
As an extra fuck you to me, I come up here and find you high as a kite smoking this shit!
You know what you fucking need to do?
Skin up. Spark up. Hurry up. Come on.
When I was 5, I knew you were dead. And I got over it.
Tonight, it was just my mum pissed off about a load of other shit. She just took it out on me.
I got to about 11.
Fucking hell.
And smoked a little bit of weed.
Morning, Mrs. Kennedy.
Morning.
14, 15. I just realised you were dead all over again.
You know, when I was young and I was naughty, my parents made damn sure that I was punished. Damn sure.
You do support me, don't you? With what I'm doing.
You have to work for the things you love.
You come in.
Made your favourite.
Some parents do, I think, have kids before really thinking about it.
Stop being angry at me!
You should be grateful because I'm your mum and I love you and I look after you and cook you dinner and let you watch TV.
I am.
I thought I was the only person like around here that, as a dead dad, I'd quite like to talk to him and like you and my mum can like start off like a widow's club or something.
Your dad died when you were like fucking 4 years old, yeah? Get over it.
Rent will be on time.
I could have a word with Paul, get you a fucking job.
Can I rely on you?
He's been there for years and years. He made me promise not to tell anyone because he loves us still.
I felt inspired.
You want to go to your mum's? Go!
You can go see him whenever you want.
Okay.
I never meant for any of this.
My name is COSMO JARVIS. I wrote and directed The Naughty Room, and I acted in it as well. And it was my first feature attempt at a feature film, and it was sort of made with limited resources. The idea for it kind of began a while ago when I was on tour, because I'm a musician as well. I was on tour and I was kind of started writing, playing around with a few ideas that I thought would be easy to execute with the resources that I thought I might be able to have access to. And it kind of started when I made a short film called The Naughty Room, which nobody ever saw, and it was just a kind of abstract weird thing about this kid that was locked in a bathroom, and they never really had any story really. And then I kind of threw it away because it didn't seem substantial enough to warrant anybody really watching it. So it's very easy for a parent to abuse power, their power, and the way that their child looks at them, because most children look at their parents is it's a programmed way of being and a programmed, it's not respect, but a parent's just an example, and it's very, and not every parent, because they've already lived a massive part of their life before they've had kids, it's not like the parent has the same responsibility to the child that the child has to the parent. That's just what I thought at the time, and I still kind of do. It was a long story because I'd never written a screenplay before, and a proper one, and so my first mistake was writing it in a really detailed way where every event, to me on paper, it had to be plausible, I wanted it to be that nothing could just happen because for the sake of it happening, everything had to lead on to the next moment. But then I ended up with a 3.5-hour movie, which I had to cut down quite considerably. A parent doing to this character Todd what this mother, Mrs. Kennedy, does in the movie, it's by anybody's standards, it's a pretty serious thing to do. But I didn't want it to be like a hostile kind of like graphic depiction of abuse, because I knew that it would be almost be too easy to do that, because all you'd have to, you know, it'd be too easy to make it like a graphic depiction of the terror and moral and emotional and mental confusion that this child would have to go through to be in this situation. So I kind of wrote this character Subaru, which is kind of the polar opposite, not the opposite, but kind of experiencing the same abuse of power from his parent and in his life as the character Todd. My primary crew was like less than 10 people, and I was a camera operator as well and a sound recordist, and all the actors were sound recordists and all boom operators, so everybody kind of rotated positions, and nobody that worked on this film had ever worked on a feature film before. So it was, and in some ways that benefited the film hugely, because it meant that things happened that weren't planned that sort of worked, and it kind of brought forward a kind of an honesty that I wouldn't have been able to have preempted or planned in any way. I guess the primary message of the whole thing would be that just because somebody is your parent doesn't mean that they have the most beneficial example to give you. Your friends can give you information and guide you through life in a way that may be better for you than somebody that is biologically your mother or father could do. And it's kind of, I wanted people to kind of leave knowing that that is, you know, with their minds open to that possibility, because we all go through it every day with our friends and stuff like that. And yeah, it didn't come from like contrived thoughts or trying to make this advice because I thought it'd be entertaining. I mean, I do think that, and in my life I got to a point with me where I would just ignore my parents because they're just full of crap mostly. I mean, they have some good things to say and some good examples to set, but often it can be quite detrimental to me and, you know, family members, children. And so, yeah, I'm ready for it. Yeah, the questions. A lot of the instrumentals of the tracks from Think Bigger are in the movie, along with a bunch of other music that I wrote. But yeah, a lot of them because, well, one, I couldn't afford to license a lot of music, so I figured that was a nice little corner to cut. Just take the vocals out of my music and stick the instrumentals down, and that worked. There's like four or five or six. There's five songs from the album in the movie, and yeah, they had their places, and yeah, it helped not drag the story along, helped tell the story. Yeah.
Amazing. Like, how did you stretch £8,000 to shoot a film for a year?
By abusing my actors, and they got cut up on the stunt scenes because like, we didn't always have, like, there were no stunt, we were the stuntmen, like, you know. The older actors playing the proper adults, the mother figures in the movie, that they kind of lived nearby and had acted before, and I, you know, and they'd come up and I'd be like, can you come shoot today? They'd be like, yeah, okay. And then they'd turn up, and it was like, it was a lot of favors, a lot of cut corners, and a lot of things that nobody who was actually making a feature film would do because it would be illegal. And you know, like, you know, we took advantage of our public surroundings. Like, if we needed to shoot something in public, we just shoot it in public rather than getting permission to go and shoot it in public, and the health and safety and the risk assessment, we could just kind of do it. And I don't know, you never know really. I mean, if anything, it probably looks a little bit more realistic, I guess, like the public scenes. And you know, my little brother, who's 19, was the production designer. My drummer was the production designer for the other half of the movie. Directors that really inspired me is, like, I like Lars von Trier a lot because I like the way that he kind of depicts emotion and mental states quite, I think, accurately. Wes Anderson, big fan of him, and it's, I don't know, I've got a lot of different favourite directors, but those guys probably are like my favourites, probably, but there's probably another one that I'm forgetting. But yeah, I just want to carry on making. I mean, I've finished this other script, and I'm going to try and my best to make that, and I'm going to I'm using the same, well, not exactly the same, but many of the same cast and crew from the last one, and just kind of keep making movies, keep churning them out, and keep like acting and doing, trying to find interesting stories and find cheap ways of executing them.
I guess. Amazing. COSMO JARVIS, you have been speaking to Ruff, and it's an absolute pleasure.
Thank you very much for having me.